Public notice of nonprofit educational fair use in compliance with Title 17, Section 107 of the United States Copyright Code. Federal law allows citizens to reproduce, distribute, or exhibit portions of copyrighted motion pictures, video media, or video discs under certain circumstances without authorization of the copyright holder. This infringement of copyright is called fair use and is allowed for purposes of criticism, news reporting, teaching, and parody. So I came across a new video on Mr. Thrive and Survive's channel that I was able to give a like to. He is promoting a Globe Earth debunk that I would like to get behind. I left him a comment, "Thanks for sharing, I missed this, liked," and I did like it. This is the video that Mr. Thrive and Survive was sharing. It's from Chris UK and it was published June 12th. Chris does an excellent job of exploiting a flaw in the heliocentric model that we can all use to show globers that they do not live on a spinning ball. And at the same time, he's given us even greater proof that the AE map and model with the sun and moon and stars doing circles around the North Pole is even more ridiculous of a possibility. Now, I do not know Chris UK, and I do not know if he is an AE map and model supporter. There are some things that he says in the video that is in support of it, and then other things that completely debunk it. Let's go through Chris's debunk of the heliocentric model, and then afterwards we'll go into depth about how this is even worse for the AE mapping model.
What I'm saying is that at different points on the globe, you should see a star or the sun moving across your view at different speeds. Right, so why does it make sense? We live on a globe, so we're told. Thousand mile an hour, 500 mile an hour, 250 mile an hour. So the Earth rotates around that point. The Sun causes terminator line there. So we've got three points where the terminator line is. There, there, and there. Right, that's 25,000 miles. Yep, that's 125,000 miles an hour. So what's the difference between these three points? The difference is that the terminator line has got to travel all the way around the globe in the same time as this terminator, this person here, has got to spin around. So the light, as the sun rises, has got to travel that distance all the way around the globe. So we'll represent the distance as a line. So that line is that distance. That line is that distance. And that line is that distance. So the terminator line has got to travel along all these distances in the same amount of time. So the difference is the distance it's got to travel. So at each point it's got to travel a different distance. So you've got the sun at each point. Cameras trained on it. You've got a man standing there with the same field of view for each man. So say that man can see a 10 mile space in the sky.
I would just like to interject right here that I totally agree that our circle of sight is about 10 miles. It actually becomes quite rare to see objects at the horizon at a distance of 20 miles, exponentially more rare at a distance of 30 miles, and super, super rare to see anything 40 miles or beyond. I have a video on my channel titled, How Far Can We See? Jaronism is deceiving you, 160-mile sunset bullcrap, plus how far can we really see? It's extremely important that this gentleman be using the correct distance that we can see for his test, and he's right on.
That man can see a 10-mile space in the sky, and that man can see a 10-mile space in the sky. The sun has got to travel fast to get to there. It's got to travel at 1,000 miles an hour to get to there. So if all these people are looking at the same space in the sky, the sun needs to travel past there the fastest. Then it's slower here. Due to its perspective, the view of the sky being all the same, that sun would be slower across that field of view. And here, slower again. So if it took a snap in time, this is at the midday point of each distance. The sun will be there for one. The next one up will be there. And this one up will be there. Because the sun you see has got to travel at different distances in the same amount of time. So that's all a 12-hour day. There and there. That's why I'm saying you should see the sun from your perspective, or any item from everyone's perspective, move faster across your field of view, depending on where you are on the globe.
Your location.
Right, this will work on the, so if two people, one there and one there, are staring at a star in space, the same thing should happen. The field of view, if you look, both stare at the same stars, with a star here, a star there, and you're looking at that one, to reference your field of view, the two people look at it, one, this will move our frame faster, the other one, slower. You get that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We don't see that.
Yeah.
Heliocentric model destroyed.
So if we're on a flat plane and we're looking up, everybody on Earth sees the stars move at the same speed.
Now that is a great point you make, and we're going to go into more detail about that.
Yes.
Because they're all spinning around us at the same speed, because we're on a flat plane. So if everyone sees them stars moving at the same speed, we're on a flat plane and the stars are moving around us. If we're on a ball, depending on where you are, you should see the star move at different speeds across the field of view. And we don't.
Because of the spin.
Because of the spin. No one's pointed this out. No one's looking at this. So that's why I think it's important. And I don't think I'm doing any credit what this is saying.
No, you
don't. It's important. Because practically, what you see in the sky is not what they're telling you.
Yeah.
So, is it the equinox soon, where the sun will be there straight across half day, half night? That could be the best time to work to see if this is true or false. It proved the ball or if it's flat straight out.
This gentleman is absolutely correct that using the equinox is the best time to do a test like this. We have the fall equinox coming up again. Everywhere on Earth, the sun will rise 90 degrees east and set 270 degrees west, and the solar noon declination will tell us exactly what latitude we're at. Another thing I like about the fall equinox is how after the fall equinox, the sunrise-sunset angles in the southern hemisphere become obvious proof that the AE map and model does not work.
It's got people in different areas of this so-called
spin.
Different area spins.
Right.
Yeah.
Not necessarily. Right. There's an experiment you can do to prove the point. Around about again, place a camera here and a camera there. Yeah? Spin the camera. Press play and spin the camera. So camera one, camera two. Right. And they'll both film the exact same thing in the exact space of time. Only when you press playback, camera one will be a nice clear picture all the way around. Camera two will be all blurred because it had to move a greater distance to film the same area at the same time. That's the key point.
Yeah.
This and this is telling you.
Yeah.
That if we're moving on a ball, that's what we should see.
Yeah, definitely.
If we're on a flat plane, we don't see that. We see everything from anywhere on the plane, one star will move at the same speed for everybody.
Yeah.
Or one point. Even the moon from several points. Even when it's moving, everyone looking at it at the same time will see it move
so
at different
speeds. So if you're
stood
on the equator, the stars should travel at 1,000 miles an hour because the Earth's meant to be spinning that.
Yeah, because basically, if you're stood there, you've got a less, for a day, you've got less miles to do a day. Here, you've got loads of miles to do.
Yeah.
So if you're on the North Pole, the sun will move really slowly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For a day, but it's only got a very short distance to go for a day. And you look at it from here, from your perspective view, not as a whole, but when you show you from space, they show you this, it all move at the same speed. But you're looking from your perspective, standing on a ball, spinning.
Okay.
So this is, for me, ultimate proof that it's flat. Motionless, and that the stars are spinning around us.
Yeah.
And that the stars are spinning around us.
Yeah.
And that the stars are spinning around us.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know if this guy knows it or not, but what he did right there was support the AE map and model. It's the popular flat Earth channels that promote the idea that the stars circle around Polaris, or the North Star. Eric Dubay, no doubt the most famous of the proclaimed flat earthers, put out a video June 30th, 2018, how the southern stars work on a flat Earth.
Earth is a level, motionless plane with the sun, moon, and stars revolving over and around us, just as you experience every day.
Now pay attention here. The key is the rotation of the sun, the moon, and the stars. It does not matter what map is beneath. What we're talking about is the model of the sun, moon, and stars rotating around North Pole.
The North Pole is the magnetic monopole center point, with Polaris, the North Pole star, situated directly above. Polaris is the only motionless star in the heavens, with all the other constellations revolving perfect circles over the Earth every night.
Now, while Eric is not technically lying to you about there just being one star in the sky that has a perfect rotation around it, he is lying by omission, because there is a place in the southern sky, located most easily by the Southern Cross, a spot called Sigma Octanus, and it also has a perfect circular rotation around it. Now, while Eric denies the existence of a southern rotation, there are other proclaimed flat earthers like Kofo72 that have done an excellent job of documenting this southern rotation. Sir, you are absolutely correct about your debunk of the heliocentric model, and your two cameras on a merry-go-round would do an excellent job of proving the point.
A roundabout again. Place a camera here and a camera there. Yeah? Spin the camera. Press play and spin the camera. So camera one, camera two. Right. And they'll both film the exact same thing in the exact space of time. Only when you press playback, camera one will be a nice clear picture all the way around. Camera two will be all blurred because it had to move a greater distance to film the same area at the same time.
What I've done here is a little bit of modeling in a program called SketchUp, which is free. Anybody can use it. It's not that hard. And I'm showing you can import images and use scaled measurements to be able to model this as far as what we should see in the world. The widest point of the United States is 2,680 miles, so on this map that comes out to 1'10" 5/8". So at approximately Quito, Ecuador, on the equator, I made a line vertically 1'5" 5/8". I turned a northern hemisphere star map into a PNG in order to get rid of the edges, and then I was able to put it in place over the AE map and model. Now, by being able to put the rotate tool on this star map, I'm able to simulate what the rotation of the stars would be like. Next, what I did is put three circles on the AE map, one at 45 degrees north, one at the equator, and one at 45 degrees south. Next, what I do is trace the lines of longitude for a familiar area of the world for many of us. I then pull up these pie pieces, the 1'10" 5/8", to the height of the star map, and it reveals the widths at these different latitudes, the 45 degrees north, the equator, and 45 degrees south. We have 6 5/16". We have 11 15/16". And we have 1'5" 15/16". It's obvious that the stars traveling down at 45 degrees south would have to be traveling way faster than the ones at the equator. But that's not what we witness. The same would be true of the sun and moon. As they were farther south, you know, the farther south you go from the equator, they would have to be traveling faster, and that's not what we witness. I'm going to show you that the sun actually travels slower in the southern hemisphere than it does at the equator. This is super easy and everyone can do it. All you need to do is pick two cities in the southern hemisphere, I'm using Sydney and Perth, and get the distance between those two cities. I am using Google Earth to do this. And I'm using SunCalc to tell me what my solar noon declination time is. So when the sun's at 360 degrees or zero, it's 12:23 UTC plus 8 in Perth. So now I move this over to Sydney, and what I'll have to do is adjust the time slider so it's at the 360 degrees or close as you can possibly get, and the time is 12:02 UTC plus 10. Now with a distance traveled of 2,061 miles at a time of 2 hours and 21 minutes, that speed is 877 miles per hour, significantly less than the 1,000 at the equator. But let's double check that. So what I'm doing right now is moving the cursor around trying to find the closest place that I can to the equator on the east coast of Africa, and I'm moving the time of day to get my azimuth to the 360 or zero, and you'll see the time is 12:15 UTC plus 3. Now I move over to the west coast of Africa and I'm looking for my location right at the equator, as close as I possibly can get on that coast. And here I begin moving my time slider until I get the solar noon of a 360 or zero on the compass heading. The time solar noon takes place is 12:29 UTC plus 1. Now the land feature on the west coast of Africa is easy to identify, so I'm clicking on that. I'm pulling over to the east coast, and I'm just going to make sure that my compass heading is 90 degrees, and this is what we were measuring to in SunCalc as well. Now, with a distance traveled of 2,310 miles in 2 hours and 14 minutes, that speed is 1,034 miles an hour. Now, what's interesting is the farther south that you try this test, the slower the speed of the sun is. So, sir, you've done a fantastic job of debunking the heliocentric model with the mandatory different speeds of the sun. And at the same time, you've completely destroyed the AE map and model and shown how ridiculous it is. I understand why everybody thinks the stars are doing circles over our head. It's what the popular flat Earth channels teach. Let's listen to just a little bit more of Eric Dubay.
But conversely, cannot see the so-called South Pole star, Sigma Octantis, the Southern Cross, or other outer constellations simultaneously from every point south of the equator, because they all sweep over a great southern arc from their rise in the evening to their setting in the morning.
Well, you see, that's just one big lie. He's a southern hemisphere observation denier, and he's been debunked by the Globe debunked proof of this gentleman that we're considering right now. There are a lot of other topics that I wish I could slam into this video right now, but I don't currently have the time to do it. So I'm going to put this one out and just let you know that the future videos are going to be discussing our circle of sight, just how large it is, how we can estimate the true size of the sun, and from there, being able to calculate the true speed of the sun. What we observe, our circle of sight, is really a super small area, and that's where all the operations of the sun, the moon, and the stars is taking place. The fact, the evidence of that is you witness it, and it's local to you, and you cannot see that far. Once you realize that the sun is rising and setting at the edge of your circle of sight, be it 10 miles, you'll see that for 12 hours, it moves very slow, some 1.5 miles an hour. The sun is not a physical object. It's not a big nuclear furnace. It's not circling around us. The speeds that we were calculating was not for a physical object. It was all about timing. But that's the reason why I'll have to cover this in more future videos.
Conversely, cannot see the so-called South Pole star, Sigma Octantis, the Southern Cross, or other outer constellations simultaneously from every point south of the equator.